this is the work that needs to get done. This is what is going to change the world.
I've been fighting human trafficking for over 12 years now. In order to really end human trafficking, we need to have hundreds of thousands of individuals around the world empowered to create solutions in their own local environment. In this interview series, I'll be talking with some of the top entrepreneurs and business leaders in the world today. So we'll be sharing both our successes and failures, things we wish we had known when we started, and a pathway for scaling your own enterprise. It's about creating a better future with empowered entrepreneurs because it's something we can't do alone. I'm with Sheryl O'Loughlin, who is the CEO of REBBL, a company that's very dear to me and not for sale. And so it's really great to connect with Sheryl around entrepreneurship and leadership. And, you know, I guess the first question for me, you know, you were at CLIF Bar, CEO, and you were one of the founders of Plum Organics. And jumping back into a CEO role is always a daunting thing after you've done it once, right? Sometimes I say, I will never do that again. And then here I am again. So how did you get motivated to go back into a CEO role, and why REBBL?
Well, that's exactly what I said, is why would I do this again? But then this brand REBBL came into my life, the brand that you created, and I was stunned by what I was learning. It had all the makings of the magic that I had seen in the past brands that have made them super successful. Everything from the product, to the brand, to the people, and to the purpose, most importantly, to the purpose.
Well, I was on the board when we interviewed you, and it was, you know, it was just your expertise that you've got this unusual combination of analytical operational skills and branding and market and a sense of the potential story. Has that always been a part of your DNA? I mean, have you always like brought that to companies you were a part of? Or
I think that is. I have, I guess, both sides of my brain that are, actually, my brain is always on 24/7. But both sides of my brain have always been important to me to make sure that I'm firing on both sides, because I think it's so important in order to bring value to the company and, I guess, work with the different team members in ways that is most motivating and helpful to them.
As I think about it, I think a lot of women entrepreneurs get pushed into the storytelling marketing role, and they don't get to play that more analytical or strategic role. Was there a time in your career when you had that opportunity where you felt like, oh, I'm getting empowered and confident in being a more diverse leader or other skills, you know?
Well, I had gone back to business school, and I had been a marketing person before that in big multinational companies. And I knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur at that point. And the finance side of it and the numbers side of it I knew were essential. So I actually forced myself in business school to go back and learn finance. I had a marketing finance degree. The finance part at first was pretty painful for me. But over time, I have just really fallen in love with it because I think the numbers tell a story. And that's what I want to get out of the numbers, is the story they tell about the health of the company.
Well, that's a great like lesson to people listening, that sometimes you do stuff and it's really hard. I mean, just, yeah. I say, well, it doesn't come naturally to me, but maybe if you really work at something, then it will come naturally later, or you'll come to appreciate it. You come to fall in love with that aspect of the business you never thought you would, right?
That's a great point. And when I look back and I think about finance, it really is in a way like an entrepreneurial path, right? You're going on the ups and the downs of this path in order to get to your goal. And I think with finance, to me, I kept thinking the whole time I was in it, this is not actually my natural place, but if I push and I go break through some of these walls with it, I'm going to get there. I had the confidence to know I would get there, and it finally did happen.
A lot of the entrepreneurs that we want to reach out to, we want to really emphasize the importance of relationships and culture. Yes. And that's something that you've really, I think, excelled at with REBBL, is that you realize that unless we have a good culture, we're not going to have a great company, right?
Absolutely.
So what are some of the keys around building culture and a relationship that you can be proud of internally, not just external facing, but internal?
To me, culture is everything, because what we do inside naturally will come out on the outside. So if we're not living our brand, the world will never see our brand. Mm. It's important for entrepreneurs to understand that culture happens whether or not you create it.
Yeah.
So the day you start, you have a culture. And so it is much better actually to be shaping that in the way that you want it to be. And it's actually a lot more fun that way.
Yeah, because the people you're around, I mean, even the board, everyone, it's almost like a mutual love fest that everyone appreciates each other on the board. And I know in the staff as well. That's a unique opportunity in a company, right? I mean, we've both been in many companies. Yeah. To experience that magic is something that you just live and celebrate, right?
It's really funny that you bring that up, because I was just talking to Dwayne, one of our fellow board members, today on the phone, and I was asking him, how'd you think the board meeting went? And he was asking me the same thing. He said, you know, what do you get out of it? Is it really helpful to you? And I said to him, I have never had a more incredible board in my life. For several reasons. One is that, especially having you on the board, we're always looking at our true north, our purpose, what we're trying to do with this company. Also, we have people that have done it. They have run beverage businesses, so the value they add every single day is remarkable.
I feel like I'm going to business school class every day.
Seriously, it's amazing. Yeah. And the people are just so caring and wonderful. And to have people like you and Dwayne and Mark and, of course, Kim, who are actually willing to use the word love, that is such a unique
love thing. In a board meeting. No, absolutely, right?
It's amazing.
Okay, so, but that's, I mean, I want the women who become strong leaders and entrepreneurs to feel like they don't have to leave that out. They don't have to, like, somehow adjust themselves to join this male world, right? That they can bring the relationships, they can bring the love. Not that men can't do that, too. As you said, there are men on our board that can do that. But oftentimes, women feel like they have to toughen up or change who they are, and you don't do that.
I think I'm too old at this point. Dave. But no, it's always been that I wear my heart on my sleeve, because I think that brings the authenticity to the company. And I think as women, what we need to understand is we're helping to shape this dialogue. So we're not there just doing our thing as women. We're actually there bringing skills in balance with the skills that men bring to create incredible organizations. And in fact, there is more and more data now that shows, actually, that women-led companies are actually more profitable than male-led companies.
Wow.
And it's very important for women to understand they can do it. Mm-hmm. They are empowered to do it. The only thing I would say is pick the right team, because the team is everything.
Yeah. Was there someone who was a really important mentor to you when you were a young entrepreneur? Can you recall that mentor? Why was that an important mentor? What was that relationship about?
Gary Erickson, the founder and now owner of CLIF Bar.
He's a great guy.
He was the most incredible mentor I've ever met in my entire life. He's the one who taught me what it means to have a company that's dedicated to a purpose. He almost sold CLIF Bar, and in that moment, he realized that's what he wanted to do with his company. He literally changed my life.
He's unflinching in his commitment to the values that got him there in the first place, right?
Absolutely not. He has created a model that very few people have been able to follow as of yet, but it's starting, and it's getting bigger and bigger, and I'm really proud at REBBL that I feel like we're almost walking in those footsteps.
Yeah. I was being asked that, you know, as REBBL has grown, have you deviated from your mission? Or are you kind of floating away from why it was started? And I said, you know, not at all. In fact, what's so inspiring about REBBL is that the way that we produce the product, the way that we source, the way that we think about our impact is in alignment with, yet independent from, Not For Sale. So it's almost like now you have two entities who are working and coordinating, but have different styles and methods and objectives, but reaching the same goal of empowering people that we touch, right? I think that's pretty exciting.
It is mind-blowing to me. And I remember when I first came to REBBL, and you had said, this Not For Sale and REBBL and the things that we're focused on are so intertwined. And the more I peel back the onion, the more I realize that at its depth of its core, that relationship is so essential. You and I spent some time talking about how together we can help truly eradicate trafficking by the way that We rehabilitate people who have been through it, through the amazing efforts that you guys do. But also, since we touch so many communities with our product and through our growers, when we empower them, we help them, as you say so eloquently, to never be vulnerable in the first place. So we work down the stream and up the stream. That is, to me, where business is going. That's where nonprofits are going. They blend together and they match perfectly when we're working together.
No, absolutely. It's like an inoculation so that we're not having to be downstream with not-for-sale rescuing because we're providing empowerment. And really, a lot of the work that we want to do with the United Nations is around empowering women so that they do not have to fall into the vulnerability. They don't have to later go to shelters. And so it's so important at this stage is to provide those tools for empowerment. And you've just written a book, and you talk a lot about the journey of being an entrepreneur and the importance of taking care of yourself.
Absolutely.
And so how can you distill that? Like, if you're a new entrepreneur, someone who wants to get into purpose-driven work, how do they take care of themselves as well?
The entrepreneur's health is at the essence of the success of the company. And so to take care of yourself, it is so important to know, as human beings, we have to be able to rest and recover. And there's going to be times where we're jamming with our companies. That's a natural part of entrepreneurship. But if we don't take the time to recover, we won't be able to give anymore. And so exercising, eating healthy, having healthy relationships, those are essential, and I learned that the hard way, so I know how essential they are.
Yeah, what I've learned as a part of something that's really healthy for the culture of the companies I've been a part of, and I noticed that you do this at REBBL, celebrate your wins. I mean, like, really take a moment, acknowledge it, celebrate it, you know, whether it's having a party or just naming it. It's a sense of inspiration. Oh, okay, you know, it's just not like, okay, like you're a machine, right?
Yes.
And so it's important to learn that, because I find a lot of companies, they don't even celebrate their wins. They spend a lot of emotional energy on their losses or failures, but they don't spend much emotional energy in a positive sense on their wins.
It's so true. And, you know, another thing that I talk about in my book that you alluded to is entrepreneurship is this ride, and it can go like this. And that's part of, to your point about being healthy, is what we need to understand is when we ride those lows too low, they're going to happen a lot in the beginning of the company. It's hard work.
Entrepreneurs should just expect them.
They should, exactly,
yeah.
Exactly, and so you can't ride those lows too low. And also, one of the things that I learned, again, the hard way, is riding the highs too high is also dangerous, because then your drop is so far. So what we need to do as entrepreneurs is make sure that as those hills or mountains are coming, that we breathe into it, and make sure that we're more riding them like you would on a wave, and more smoothly, because that is, again, going to help to sustain our health, and not only of ourselves, but the people that we work with.
Mm-hmm. One thing that really impresses me about you as a leader is that you have what I call an aggressive humility, that you're very proactive, but you're also humble enough to say, hey, I could be smarter this week than I was last week, and learn along the way. So you're a learning leader. So what have you learned by being the CEO of REBBL? What are some of the things that have happened that you said, well, I'm getting smarter, or I've been learning? Are there things unexpected or things that you've learned on this journey? It's only been maybe 2 years now, but.
Yeah. My God, so much. It's an overwhelming question. You know, one of the things, again, and through the relationship with Not For Sale that I learned is how much the product itself and what we put in that product can truly affect communities. Yeah. And the fact that the ingredients that we choose can lift someone's livelihood to the point where they may not be vulnerable anymore to trafficking, that is mind-blowing to me. And it is a totally different way of looking at building in purpose to the essence of your business, to the beginning of where your supply chain is. That, to me, and seeing how REBBL approached it, was actually mind-blowing to me.
Yeah, that whole notion of impact, I call impact sourcing, that we impact, by the way, and as you say, just like there's a culture happening, whether you make it or not, there is an impact whether you direct it or not, right? And so it's just we've intentionally at REBBL decided, no, we want to impact it in a positive way, right? Yeah. And so when I see those ingredients, I think of stories. I don't see just plants. They are plants, and it's beautiful that we're a plant-based drink, but also I see a story behind every ingredient.
Absolutely. It's so incredible to be able to talk about it with consumers in dialogue. And I always hated the word marketing. It always bothered me. And I'm so proud to feel like every time we talk about REBBL, it's in conversation, and it's an invite to bring people in to learn more about this brand, learn more about their impact that they can have. And how empowering is that in this crazy world with some crazy things going on now? Yeah. To be able to feel like with a business in partnership with a nonprofit, that we actually can make a difference from where we stand.
Yes, exactly.
That's incredible.
You don't need to go to Calcutta at the end of the year. You don't need to go and build a school in Guatemala. Right. Every day when you wake up, you can work for purpose, which is pretty inspiring.
Pretty inspiring. You want to move mountains for the company when you could do that. And that's what I've been so grateful for, to have the experiences that I've had with the different companies that I've been part of, is to watch people in the company, to have them come into the door and their eyes light up, that they are in a place that they feel like they're making such a difference.
Yeah.
It's such an incredible feeling.
CLIF Bar, Plum Organics, REBBL. I mean, you have these cereals, like, you know, you're like Derek Jeter in baseball or Tom Brady. No, seriously.
That.
So I have so many young women, including my own daughter, who says, how can I meet, Sheryl? Would you introduce me to Sheryl? So you don't have to meet all these people. What would you say to them? What's the advice? Like, how do you get to that level where, you know, you're not a one-hit wonder, you're doing it consistently? Like, what's your advice to young women entrepreneurs who want to be you?
Oh, Dave, that's an overwhelming thing to say. Thank you. I don't know about that, but what is so important for women is to believe in themselves and to know that they can do it, and know that what is essential for that, you brought up earlier, is learning. And we don't have to feel like we have it all when we walk into a situation. And there's studies that talk about how men are willing to just go out there and do it and have the confidence that, of course, they have the experience, where women tend to want to make sure for 100% that they have the experience. Yeah. We don't need that. We just need to be open to learn always.
Yeah, absolutely. And I find that a lot of young women that I've worked with is that they are so equipped and talented to do something. They go, oh, but I'm not ready for that. And I go, what do you mean you're not ready?
Yeah.
It's the internal voice. And it's so, probably internalizing an external voice, but that they've heard from the time they were young.
Yes.
But you had to overcome that. Is there experience, or do you remember a time in your life where you had that crossroads where you had to overcome that and say, no, I can do it?
You know, I had the unique experience of being raised by a single mom. So I was always the oldest one. And as my brothers used to say, Sheryl's the boss. So I was almost from a young age forced into a situation where I was the boss. And so to me, throughout my career, it came somewhat naturally, but I have such empathy for women that as they're going through it, because I know as a kid how I felt having to go into that role and how scary that was for me, and how I had to just, you know, hold my breath and just try it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's so important for women to understand. Just do it, let go, and just do it. And you'll be amazed as to what happens. And you will screw up. Mm-hmm. I screw up all the time. Still to this day, I have so much to learn. But it's just keep on pushing through. Keep on learning. Know that you'll get there.
Mm-hmm. You fail forward, you know, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, so what do we learn from that? Let's move forward on that. So you, you have been a part of several great companies. Is there a moment when you look out 10, 15 years from now and say, you know, what would I end up liking to do one day? And what is it that, you know, you have this aspiration, sitting on a beach, some people say, or are you just doing now what you're doing, you know?
It's such a good question. Someone asked me about that at a talk I was at last night too. And, you know, my whole life, I always think of, you know, for your life to have a theme. And it's a theme of kind of what you want to, the little bit you can leave on the world. And to me, and you brought up the word earlier. It's all about love. And if I feel like I can give to a company and give to a team and give to a board and give to my sons and give to my husband a feeling of that I cared about them and that I made a difference in their lives, that's all that matters to me. And so whether it be REBBL, where I feel like I'm able to do that, or for the rest of my life doing that just with my family, holding hands with my husband, hopefully forever, that's what's important to me. So in this moment, I'm living it, man. I'm living it.
That's great. No, that's awesome. You've been around a lot of nonprofits, a lot of organizations that care about the world. What is it about Not For Sale that you find unique, maybe in ways that you haven't connected with other nonprofits in your life?
Dave, when you and I spent some time together and I realized the way you look at the model of where nonprofits need to go, and you're demonstrating that through the work that you're doing, in the fact that we can't have this old, broken, non-for-profit model that is all just about waiting for donations and going out and trying to talk to wealthy people or foundations or organizations that helps. But your model of how to do it in a very different way through partnership with business has changed the whole way I look at nonprofits. That is the model that we need to get to. And I am so happy that Not For Sale has this voice in front of the UN, because this is the work that needs to get done. This is what is going to change the world. So Not For Sale is changing the world in my mind.
You know, we say that if you're really going to bring about significant change or growth, you need capital, talent, and technology. And when I was in the Silicon Valley world, that's what I looked for: the best capital, the best talent, the best technology. And I remember when I first started Not For Sale, I was like, let me see, how did I get into a place where I look for donations, not capital, I take volunteers, not talent, and I get used computers? Like, what went wrong, right? Like, what? And so, it struck me that we need the best talent. And I look at REBBL as like an incredible model, because I've got Sheryl O'Loughlin as the CEO of the company I started. And it's like the best talent in the world, and she's my CEO. I said, every day, I know you're selling beverage and you're making sure you have a great company. I say, no, Sheryl's fighting human trafficking every day. And it's just wonderful they're both true.
It makes me so proud, Dave. I could cry right now. It is really, what a gift to be part of this company and be part of this organization with Not For Sale. Truly, thank you.
Well, thank you. Being a team.
All right. Right on, man. I love it.